To come here and honor and celebrate and worship our God. And lastly, I want to thank God for my babies, for my girls, for Cameron, Dee Dee, Kendall, and Kai. I thank God for them. Those of you all who have kids understand how difficult it can be to get everybody together all at the same time. But I thank God for them that they were attentive to one another and helpful this weekend and helping me to prepare and get ready for this morning. So I just wanted to tell you I love you. I thank God for you and I bless the Lord that I'm able to be your dad.
Amen.
So with that, I want to go to our word this morning. It's going to come from the Gospel of Luke. Luke's Gospel, the 18th chapter. Join me in the 18th verse. That's Luke 18. We're going to start at 18. And I believe I have the English Standard Version. Luke 18. And 18. We have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. So it reads this way. And a ruler asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother." And he said, "All these I have kept from my youth." Yes. When Jesus heard this, he said to him, "One thing you still lack." Really, Jesus? "Sell all that you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me."
Yeah.
But when he heard these things, he became very sad, for he was extremely rich. Amen. Thus ends the reading of God's holy word. So for the balance of time that I have for preaching, I want us to focus in on this title, this topic, the key to the kingdom.
Amen.
The key to the kingdom. You know, life can sometimes be challenging and confusing. Quite frankly, life can just be flat out messy.
Yes.
We think we've got a handle on things, and then sometimes something happens.
Yes.
There's an occurrence, there's an event. Something comes along to throw us off our course. We're walking and we're journeying and we're living the so-called good life. Or as it's popular today, we're living our best life. But then something happens. This thing just kind of comes our way and we get thrown off course. We somehow find ourselves off track. And then the thing that we typically do is we look for solutions. We look for, how do I get back to that place where I was?
Yeah.
How do I get back to that place that was comfortable, that was convenient, that felt good? Everything was working out, Lord. And now I'm in this sort of detour that just doesn't seem right. Yeah. And we look all around. And we look for a solution.
Yeah.
We look to God, but we also look elsewhere.
Yes.
Right? We consider the Lord, but we also consider other things. And so the immediate red flag that should be identified with this type of practice where we look for solutions and we include God rather than just look at God, this type of practice, this is a red flag because it places God in a position of inferiority. Where we look at God as a resource rather than the source.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We look at God as an option rather than the only choice.
Yeah.
And I want to suggest today that that's the type of thinking and practice that is occurring here in our text. We find an individual using that same method or principle in his thinking. So he comes in and he asks Jesus this question. He says, "Good teacher, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life?" Now, you got to understand that most scholars and theologians agree that the ruler was probably a leader in a synagogue or even a member of the Sanhedrin, which would indicate that he had a stable foundation with the law. So what's he really asking? Why is he coming to Jesus asking him about eternal life when he himself is a scholar or one who judges the affairs in Jewish life? So what I'm saying is he would have already understood the law. And the law would have already indicated to them how to be righteous, how to be made whole. So what is he doing coming to Jesus? He would have known the Ten Commandments, the ceremonial and sacrificial laws of the Jews. Why then would he approach and ask Jesus, the Jewish carpenter from Nazareth, Mary's baby, Joseph's son, why would I go to him? In other words, what motivated his investigation? We got to ask ourselves, when we're in a place where we're unsure of things, what motivates us to go to God? Yeah. What motivates us to go to someone else? Mm-hmm. Is it because we want to be made right, because we truly want to understand what's happening? Or is it we just want to get over? We just want to end this suffering. We want to end this despair as quickly as possible and use whatever method that will get us to that place. Maybe he had heard about the miracles performed by Jesus. Maybe he had heard about Jesus' teachings. Maybe he had heard the rumors circulating about Jesus' claim to be the Jewish Messiah. Well, we can't exactly be sure of his motivation. However, we do get a glimpse or a clue from the text. See, the ruler used the word good to describe Christ, which was appropriate since Christ was and still is the only one who is completely upright and honorable.
Yes.
But see, in the instant, the usage of good, in this instance, the usage of good was inappropriate, because the word itself in this context would not have been used to address a Jewish rabbi.
Yes.
See, when you look at that word in its context, when you research that word means upright and honorable. There were no human beings alive that in and of themselves would have been considered upright and honorable.
Yes. Yes.
So, you know, it's like when your kids come to you and they're trying to butter you up. I love it. Kayla's not here, and if she's watching, baby girl, you know you do this. Daddy? Oh, daddy. Oh, great sir. Oh, honorable father. Now, believe me, those are some great things. But I'm not always good. I'm not always honorable. Yes, I'm her father, but it's the same way. So he's coming to Jesus with this pretense. He's not coming to Jesus particularly in a sincere fashion. He said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?"
Yes, yes.
You know, he's an elite member of Jewish society, but despite his pedigree, perhaps he was unsure if that was enough for eternal life. He was trying to bargain with Jesus. He's here saying he had a nagging suspicion that he had done all that was required for kingdom inheritance, and perhaps he wanted to be reassured.
Uh-huh.
Have you ever walked in this life and thought, you know, I just want to make sure, I just want to do a check-in, Lord. I'm scared of COVID, so let's do this telehealth visit.
Uh-huh.
Let's do this, let me call you up and find out if we're good, if I'm doing what I'm supposed to do.
Yes, yes.
But again, we take all of the things that we've done and we bring them to God as if this is enough. Mm-hmm. As this is sufficient. You know, I'm climbing the ladder and now I've got some things. And so I just want to make sure I'm good by the standard that I set. Even though I'm saying I want to be set by the standard you set, but it's really, I want to make sure I'm good by my standard. And so Jesus, already knowing the young ruler's heart, answers his question with a question. I love Jesus. I love how when you see him in the Bible, in the Holy Scriptures, Jesus does not answer the question outright. Because Jesus is always teaching, he's always instructing, he's always trying to lead us to the right place.
Yes.
He could have easily gave him the answer, but he said, well, let me help you walk this road, this line that you think you're walking. And what does Jesus say? He first says, well, why do you call me good? What's that about?
Right. Yes.
What are you really getting at? No one is good except for God.
Right.
So do you really believe that I'm God? Or are you just trying to justify yourself because you think you're equal with God? Are you trying to say that you're on the same level as God? See, Jesus ain't no fool. Jesus knows what the game is. Jesus understands us because he created us. And so he says, he's trying to get him. He said, Jesus does what I like to call a gut check. He gut punches him and says, why are you calling me good, bro? What is that about? Right? Jesus, in his response, was not in any way suggesting that he wasn't good, right?
Uh-huh.
Or God. Rather, he was leading the ruler to confront his preconceived notion of goodness.
Mm-hmm.
See, a lot of us think that we're good because of the way that we act, how we treat one another, right? If I'm nice to people, then I'm good. I'm a good person. If I pay my taxes, I'm a good person. If I don't play my music too loud, then I'm a good person. And you know, if I don't say racist words, then I'm a good person. If I give to the needy, then I'm a good person. And we all have these preconceived notions of what goodness is. And that's looking through a flawed lens.
Mm-hmm.
That's looking through the lens of humanity.
Yes.
Because if we look at it through the lens of humanity, well then yeah, of course, that can be our standard of goodness. But then even within that, we might say, well, you're not as good as me because I've done more than you.
Uh-huh.
Right? So now we got gradients or levels of goodness. So I'm the goodest of them all. Right? I'm the goodest of them all because I've got all of these things. Well, what about the one beneath you? They're not as good as you because they don't have those things? So the lens is flawed. The lens is improper. The ruler, yes, he was rich. He was in a position of authority. He, in his mind, just needed Jesus to co-sign his belief about himself. How many of us have ever gone to God to get him to co-sign our thinking of ourselves? Paul said that we ought not think so highly of ourselves.
Yeah.
Right? That we should be humble. But there are times we give a big hand about ourselves because somebody done told us we cute. Somebody done told us we look good. Somebody done told us we smell good. Somebody done told us we sound good. Somebody gave us a compliment and now we're getting full of ourselves.
Uh-huh.
And it just starts to build and build and we're like, okay, Lord, co-sign that.
Yeah.
Tell me I'm beautiful. Tell me I look good. And while that may be true because we're created and made in the image and the likeness of God, but it ain't for you to go out and think that you're better than somebody else. It's not for us to be superior to others.
Yeah.
So Jesus is really breaking this man down to the truth. Let me get you to the place where I can actually help you out because where you are now, you're blinded. He's blinded by his ambition. He's blinded by this preconceived notion of goodness.
Yes.
And what it takes to get to the kingdom of God. He's using his stuff as a down payment on his salvation.
Uh-huh.
It's like he walked into the dealership and said, hey God, hey Lord, all of this stuff should be enough for you to give me that salvation. Here, God, take my time feeding the hungry and the money I donated to charity and the title in front of my name and the degree behind my name and take this as the down payment on my salvation. And just like the young ruler, we do the same thing. We try to purchase the key that is not for sale. See, the key to the kingdom is not for sale, saints. Look at the text. Jesus says, you know the commandments. Don't commit adultery, don't murder, don't steal, don't bear false witness, and honor your mother and your father. And he said, all of these I have kept from my youth.
Yeah.
Right? That's his response. That's him saying, Lord, you know, I did all that stuff, man. That's easy. That's a piece of cake. I've done that ever since I was a little boy. Mm-hmm. Notice with me, if you will, the commandments that Jesus listed. Mm-hmm. Right? Jesus listed the 5th through the 9th commandments, which established proper conduct between members of the community. It's easy for us to say that we're good horizontally. It's easy for us to say that I'm treating my neighbor right, or I'm doing what I'm supposed to do according to my understanding of the neighbor.
Amen.
Put it another way, these commandments focused on our human relationship. By referring to these commandments, Jesus began his deconstruction of the young ruler's flawed foundation. See, the young ruler thought he had it all, right? But in reality, he was missing the most important piece to life's puzzle. He believed himself to have everything when in fact he had nothing. He had nothing. See, that's what life apart from Christ feels like. It's transactional rather than relational. We stay faithful to our spouses. Check. We refuse to physically destroy another human life. Check. We don't take things that don't belong to us. Check. We tell the truth. Check. We respect our parents. Check. We tally up the transactions as if they equal an amount commensurate with the cost of salvation, only to find they don't measure up at all. We get this laundry list and say, God, look at what I've done. And God says, you haven't done enough. God says, well, do this one thing. One thing you still lack. I hear all of that stuff, and that's great, but there's still one thing that you lack. And he says, sell all that you have and distribute to the poor and you will have treasure in heaven. And then he says, and then come and follow. Right? Jesus, in his response, led the young ruler to take inventory of himself. See, the selling of his possessions and giving them away to the poor was an opportunity for the young ruler to demonstrate his obedience to the first commandment.
Yes.
See, he, Jesus said, okay, that's good. You did 5 through 9. But what about the first one? What about the one that is on top? What about the one that is the most significant? Because that is between here. That's God and us. That's the vertical relationship. How about that?
Yes.
You shall have no other gods before me. Right? This commandment establish the proper conduct for the people unto God. And saints, God designed us to be or to desire fellowship and community. Jesus extended grace so that the young ruler could rebuild his foundation. Thank you, Lord. He built us with a need to be connected to him. You hear that, saints? God built us, designed us, in order that we would have a desire to be connected to each other. It's an image of the Trinity. God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In community, in connection. That's how we function within the body. And so we're born with this desire. We're born with this lack. We're born with this hole. Because we talked about it in Bible study, it's a part of our inheritance.
Yes.
calls us to be reconciled unto our Creator. Therefore, it is only in our finding and connecting to God that we receive what we've been lacking.
Yes.
The key to the kingdom. Life, real and eternal life, is found in the exchange between what appears to be good and what is actually good. What appears to be good and what's actually good. Do you see it in the text? He said, one thing you still lack. Sell all your possessions and give them to the poor, and then you will have treasures in heaven. Do you see the exchange?
Yes.
And then he says, come follow me.
Yes.
There's an exchange that happens from what is not real to what is real.
Amen.
Saints, some of us have been living that way.
Yes.
We've been storing up this fool's gold. We've been putting things to the side that we believe are valuable and have worth. And God is saying, yeah, that's all fine and good, but once it's over, once this life ends, that's going to pass away.
Amen.
That's not going to last. Honestly, it'll still be here. Meanwhile, what really matters is where your soul is.
Yes, yes, yes.
You want that peace with God, that tranquil state of a soul assured of its salvation. That's the key. That's what we're after. So, rich young ruler, you really want to inherit the kingdom? Get rid of it. Let it go. None of that stuff matters. And then come, follow me. See, it's not just enough to get rid of the stuff. Because we can always fill that stuff back up.
Yes.
We can always go back out and get more stuff. But see, when we get rid of the stuff, Jesus forces us to choose to move away from that place where we are stuck and then to follow after him where we can't collect those things.
Yes.
Because all that we're focused on is him. We're journeying to the kingdom. But see, look at the text. Jesus invited him to receive the answer to the original question regarding kingdom inheritance, but the young ruler was disappointed with the directive, which in my mind suggests that he had an expectation. Have you ever had an expectation of God? Have you ever asked God and then God gives you an answer and you're just like, geez, Lord, really? I gotta do that? Come on now. You know how hard I worked for that? You know how much I saved up and then to get here? You know how I sacrificed and now I'm here in this position and now I've reached the top and you want me to leave? Do you know what position that's going to put me and my family in? Do you know that people are depending upon me? You're asking me to be something that I'm not. And Jesus saying, no, I'm actually asking you to be what you're supposed to be. So you think it's about your title. You think it's about the letters behind and in front of your name. You think it's about those that you supervise, or you think it's about all of these other things that really don't matter. It's not about the house. It's not about the car. It's not about the clothes. It's not even really about the health and wellness.
Amen.
It's about a secure relationship with our God, with our Creator.
Yes.
And for some reason, the rich young ruler, he couldn't see that value. The Bible says that he went away sad because he was extremely rich. It's like when they put that word extremely, right, that adjective, it's an exorbitant amount of wealth. And he wasn't willing to give any of it away. So it sounds to me like he really didn't want kingdom inheritance.
Amen.
Sounds to me like he would rather die separate from God, rich, than to be in the position of having true wealth,
amen,
which is with God,
amen,
and living the way that God would have him to live. See, as the young ruler departed the presence of Christ, he did so declaring that his wealth, his royal clothing, his position, his title, his dwelling, his servants, his abundance of land, food, and livestock was worth more than a relationship with Christ. He decided in that moment to remain justified by his standards, rather than by God's standards. He made his choice. As the saying goes, he made his bed and he chose that this is what he would lie in. And see, family, a legacy of surrender and submission to God is far more valuable than any amount of silver or gold, any title or position that humankind would offer. The relationship with God is the legacy that we want to give to our children and our children's children and their children. That's what we want to leave them, because that is truly what will last. It's not about the money. Money comes and goes. Money's going to be spent and earned. But money only has value because somebody assigned it value. If it was before, in the Roman days, it was salt. Salt was valuable. That's how they paid the soldiers. That's where we get the word salary. Salt. But you don't see people scrambling out here for salt. Right? It lost its value because we no longer assign it value. But God says, come, follow me. Give up all of that stuff that you think is really valuable. TLC said it. Don't go chasing waterfalls. Please stick to the rivers and the lakes that you're used to. Right? The river and the lake. Right? That's God. That's our place of sustenance and sustaining and strength and resist. All of that is found in God.
Amen.
So don't get caught up in the hype of this world. Don't go after that which doesn't provide what God is providing.
Thank you, Lord.
Right? And hear me well. I'm not saying that in this text that people often misunderstand what God was saying. God was not, so Jesus was saying, Jesus was not saying that rich people could not inherit the kingdom of God. Christ was coming to help folks understand that it wasn't by works. It wasn't by, right? You couldn't purchase the kingdom. You could not earn the kingdom. Yes, we want to live a good life. And yes, if God blesses you with those things, praise God for you. And yes, if you go after those things, praise God for you. But God really, what Jesus was doing was establishing what was really valuable and what the heart should desire. So our heart should desire him above all those things. He said it in Matthew 6:33, right? But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Because all the other things that you're concerned with and worried about, that's going to be given to you. So what do we really want? Do we really want the key to the kingdom? Or do we want to be left outside on the porch, waiting to get in? See, the key is what allows access. The key is what turns the lock and opens the door, and then you can walk through it. But if you don't have the key, all you're doing is knocking. And believe me, God has the best security system ever. So those that don't have the key will not be allowed entry into the kingdom. Well, be it for us to be standing on the outside saying that, walking away disappointed because this was the requirement to give up the things that we thought were valuable and to come and follow after Jesus and to live in a way that would bring him glory and honor, to submit and surrender ourselves wholly unto God. That's the key, saints. That's the key. Let's stop chasing the money and start chasing the master.
Amen.
Amen.
Jesus told the young ruler to come and follow him. And I want to say this. Following Christ is not a one-time event. Right? Jesus told me to follow him. I did. I'm good now. Right? No. It is a every day until the Lord returns or calls us home. That is, come follow me. It's a lifestyle change. Y'all remember them shows of, what is it, TLC, where the person comes in dressed And my friend was like, I really want them to change the way they look. And then the stylist would come and give them a few different outfits and say, okay, now this is the way that we're going to style you. And then they walked away looking better. And from then on, they were supposed to now start dressing like that.
Yeah.
And God says, listen, I brought you before me, and this is the way you were looking. And yeah, it was okay for a while, but now there's time for transformation. There's a new look that I want you to wear every single day that I give you. Every time you wake up in the morning, you put on some love. You put on some forgiveness. You put on some grace. You put on some mercy. You walk in this way, bearing my image so that you are rightly representing me and showing others how to get into the kingdom. We come to this place that God calls us to be. It's incumbent upon us to do this, not just for ourselves, but again for others. And so here it is. The world, and to a lesser degree, society, espouses a focus on self-satisfaction and self-preservation. Mm-hmm. We've seen that, saints. The world teaches us that we ought to take care of ourselves first before we take care of anybody else. Wow. The world tells us to get ours while we can. And then once we've gotten ours while we could, then go and help somebody else. That's not how Christ works. Yeah. It feeds us a steady diet of messaging that suggests to focus on insignificant things such as beauty, fashion, and fame. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you how every time you watch a program, the commercials, all of them focus on self.
Yes.
Get this cream, buy this car, get this thing to help enhance your figure. It's all about the self. It's never about God.
Yes.
It's never about serving others or helping others. It's always focused on us. We learn from an early age that success is garnered through acquisition, and therefore pursue that which we believe promises prosperity.
Yes.
We only go after what's going to make us better or feel better. Mm-hmm. Oh, church, eternal life is obtained by faith alone in Christ alone, flat out. Material wealth is well and good. However, it will not open the door to the kingdom.
Amen.
If future generations are going to be the heritage of a legacy of trusting and following Christ, then we have to continue to maintain its integrity. We are the ones that hold up the integrity and maintain the integrity and the strength of the message. We are the ones that protect against the adulteration and the confusion that the world seems to try and put on it, right? The world tries to spin what the church and the Bible and God says. But we, the true disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, are the ones that have to protect it, that have to uphold it, in order for the generations coming after us to receive the truth. That's what the apostles were doing. When they were going out there and spreading the gospel, they gave the truth. And then they revisited those places so that the truth remained in place. So that what was taught would continue from generation to generation to generation. That's what's been going on for 30 years here in Hope Church. Amen. The truth has been going forward from generation to generation to generation. And the truth will continue to go forth from generation to generation to generation. Because we are and already have that blessed legacy. But we have to maintain it, saints. We have to be the ones to keep it preserved. We have to uphold and protect the truth. So, saints of God, let's commit ourselves to helping others understand the key to the kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Let's stand.
Will you?
Jesus gave opportunity for this young rich ruler to make a choice. He gave him something that he rightly did not deserve, because that's who Christ is. He gave him the chance to choose this precious gift. This gift of salvation. This key to kingdom inheritance. But the rich young ruler in his angst and, dare I say, foolishness, walked away from the answer to the very question that he asked Christ. If you're here today and if you're watching online, don't be that rich, the young rich ruler. God is calling specifically to you. He's offering you the very thing that you have been searching for. You've been seeking satisfaction. You've been seeking rest. You've been seeking peace in your mind, in your heart. You want to know what's missing. Maybe you've accumulated all these things, but you still have a sense of emptiness and loneliness and unfulfillment. And Christ is saying, come and follow me. If that's you today, choose Christ.
Amen.
Make him your Lord and Savior.
Amen.
Lord, because he is the ruler. Savior is because he died for you.
Amen.
He loves you. He loves you. Perhaps you're here today and you have accepted Christ, but you still continue to bounce from church to church. You haven't established roots where you can grow, mature, and develop as a child of the Most High God. Yes, it's great to fellowship and to hear a word, but it's also important that you're grounded and rooted in a local assembly where you can operate in your gifting, where you can be used by God to help to build and advance his kingdom. Hope Church is not a perfect place, but we do serve a perfect God. We make mistakes and we come and fall short of God's glory. But it's part of our growth. It's part of us maturing in the love of Jesus Christ. So if you're here today, you're online, you've considered Hope Church, join us today. Don't let another Sunday go by where you're not a member, where you're not a connected disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ in this house. We see there are none, but there's always, and I mean always, room at the cross. You may be seated in the presence of our God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. So we just have a few quick announcements. As always, don't forget to give God your tithe, his tithe and your offering. The boxes are here at the doors. You can give online through the church website, through Cash App or Zelle, or you can send it in through the mail. Want to continue to lift up First Lady and her family, as services are going to be held for her brother. who passed away last week. We want to continue to lift up Brother Felix and his family and their loss. And all those who have suffered bereavement either this week or last week, or as you continue to live without that loved one, we lift you up and pray for you. Continuing to pray for the sick among us, those that are struggling in their physical body. We want to keep them in our prayers. And certainly, again, want to remind everyone about Bible study. Come on out Thursdays, 7 p.m. We are learning. We are growing together as a body of Christ, as a local assembly. And this Thursday will be our praise and preaching Thursday. And I'm telling you, if you weren't here for the first one, you really missed out. It's going to be good. So I pray that each one of you will come out. I said it last Sunday. Those of you who are here, I pray that I can see you in service on Thursday at 7 p.m. So praise and preaching is happening this Thursday. And what's coming soon is our 30th church anniversary. Amen. And we want to participate. We do have a flyer. Reverend Dwyer, this is Renee, are the chairpersons for the anniversary committee. And in their absence, I'm just going to let you know that.